Good morning, everyone. Today we will understand anionic stripping voltammetric methods, and these are really very advanced methods to be used for the analysis of environmental samples, water samples, food samples, then biological samples. So by using these methods, we can analyze the traces of heavy metals even at a very low concentration in their trace quantities. It is possible to detect them by using this technique. So what is anionic stripping voltammetry? It is a technique of voltammetry, but when you talk about the stripping voltammetry, they are actually characterized by their unusually high sensitivity and selectivity. And here what we are doing, the analyte is accumulated before it is determined, and that both accumulation and determination are electrochemical processes for which the process can be controlled. So here what we are doing, we are accumulating our analyte and then the electrochemical determination is done. So if you compare this technique to the conventional polarographic method, the determinations by stripping voltammetry, they are generally more sensitive by a factor of 10 raised to power 3 to 10 raised to power 5. And the detection limits are actually between 10 raised to power minus 9 to 10 raised to power minus 11 mole per liter. So these are the really very minute quantity, trace quantities. Even in that quantity, if a heavy metal or metal ion is present in your sample, it can be detected by using the stripping method. And sometimes even the quantity around 10 raised to power minus 12 mole per liter. So this is the reason of successful applications of stripping method in the analysis of different type of samples. Now here the term stripping, it stands for the fact that during the determination, the accumulated analyte is removed from the working electrode, and this process can be followed voltammetrically or potentiometrically or chronopotentiometrically. So this is expressed by the terms stripping voltammetry, stripping potentiometry and stripping chronopotentiometry. So accumulation always takes place at the constant potential. So that is your EACC, that is the accumulation potential at a stationary mercury drop or mercury film, graphite or noble metal electrolyte for a controlled period. So that controlled period, you call it accumulation time, that is TACC. So for the time TACC, that is your accumulation time, you provide the potential, a constant potential on the working electrode, that is ECC. And during that time and at that potential, at that particular potential, your metal ion under study, it gets accumulated over the working electrode. So the analyte is deposited electrolytically as a metal, as a sparingly soluble mercury compound, or adsorptively as a complex compound. So these are the three different possibilities by which you can accumulate your metal ion in trace that is under study. So this is possible that you accumulate it as a metal. If suppose you are reducing that metal ion, then it can be accumulated as a metal. Suppose if you have applied a mercury layer on your electrode, then it is possible that the metal ion can form amalgam with the mercury and it will get accumulated over the working electrode surface. And the third possibility is you can adsorb it selectively by forming certain complex. So in that case, you have to apply the complexing species on the electrode surface, and when you apply the accumulation potential for accumulation time, then your metal ion will be selectively adsorbed on the electrode surface by forming some complex. So these are the possibilities for accumulation phase. Now after the accumulation, the analyte, the analytical species that is accumulated, it is removed from the working electrode, and that is what, that is the stripping part. So the first step is the accumulation step, and the second step is stripping step. So Here, the real determination, that is by an oxidation or reduction process, is done. So when the stripping takes place, now the actual electrochemical behavior of the metal ion will be seen. So in order to differentiate the stripping voltammetric method, in which the determination takes place by oxidation of the accumulated product, the term anodic stripping voltammetry is used. So the anodic stripping voltammetry, it is when your stripping part that involves oxidation process, right? So suppose if I have to analyze some metal ion, so first of all I will accumulate that metal ion on the electrode surface, and that will be by the process of reduction generally. So the metal ion will undergo reduction. Now during the stripping process, if I need to see the electrochemical behavior, so you have to perform the oxidation of that accumulated metal. So generally oxidation occurs on the anodic part of the cell, and therefore when you are performing this technique for any metal, for analysis of metals, you use the anodic stripping voltammetry. So it is also known as ASV. There is another possibility that if you are performing the reduction of your species during the stripping process, then you call it cathodic stripping voltammetry. So cathodic stripping voltammetry is very less utilized, because generally we are analyzing the metal ion in the solution, and they always undergo, they can be detected by the ASV, that is anodic stripping voltammetry. But some organic compounds, for their detection we are using the cathodic stripping voltammetry. But yes, it is a lesser used technique as compared to ASV. So when you are using the adsorptive accumulation of the analyte during your accumulation step, then you call it adsorptive stripping voltammetry, that is ADSV. So these are the three possibilities when you talk about the stripping voltammetry. It could be anodic stripping voltammetry, cathodic stripping voltammetry, and adsorptive stripping voltammetry. So in this diagram, you can see these are the electrodes. We have hanging mercury drop electrode in the voltammetric apparatus. Then we can use a carbon-based electrode, and this is a gold electrode. So these electrodes we can use in the stripping voltammetry method. Now from this diagram you can understand that what is the stripping voltammetry. So this is my electrode. Suppose this is my carbon based electrode, and these are the carbon molecules, carbon atoms on the electrode. Now what happens, this is prior to the mercury deposition. So you take your carbon electrode and then you apply a layer of mercury over it, over the carbon molecules. So these are the mercury atoms attached over the electrode. Now when you apply a particular potential, right, so the mercury will be settled on the surface of the electrode. So what will happen, mercury dye positive that was initially present in your salt, it will go towards your working electrode, which is behaving like a cathode, right, because it is providing electrons. So the mercury 2 plus ions, they will go towards the electrode under the electric potential, and they will gain electron, and they will be deposited on your working electrode. So there will be a layer of mercury on your electrode. Then this is the accumulation step. So your analyte free concentration at minus 900 millivolt. So now you apply again the E accumulation, that is accumulation potential, on the working electrode. Again it is behaving like a cathode, and the metal ions in the traces which are present in your sample, like here you can see the copper dye positive ion, the lead dye positive ion, cadmium dye positive ion, they could be there in the sample that you have taken. So when they gain electron from this electrode, they selectively enter into the mercury layer and form amalgam. So when this amalgam is formed, now this is what, this is the accumulation step. So here your metal ions are getting accumulated, and the time taken for this accumulation is, this is accumulation time, that is TACC, and the potential that you applied here for the process of accumulation, this is your accumulation potential, that is ECC. So you applied ECC for the time TCC, and by that time, what happens? All the metal ions present in your sample, even in the traces, even in very minute quantity, they get accumulated inside the layer of mercury by the formation of amalgam. So this was the accumulation step. The next is, now you have to identify these metal ions. So now the second step is your stripping step. So you strip selectively these metal ions. And how do you do that? You, now your working electrode becomes an anode. Like you can see, the electrons are now flowing from the electrode. So it is becoming an anode. And when it becomes an anode, the oxidation of the metal ion take place. And now these metal ions, which were present inside the layer of mercury in the form of mercury amalgam, now they will leave the electrode. How they do that? They will leave this mercury layer by their oxidation. They will release two electrons, and again, now they are converted into their dipositive ions. So these electrons are released on the anode, and there is a oxidation of your metal ions, oxidation of your accumulated metal ions. And in this manner, at the anode, you are determining the concentration of metal ions. So therefore, it is generally called as anodic stripping voltammetry. So whenever you are studying any metal ions, you will always use ASV, that is anodic stripping voltammetry. So after this, you can record the current and voltage, and then you can plot a graph like a normal voltammetric technique. And by using the E half potential values, you can identify the metal ion. So this anodic stripping voltammetry, this can be used to determine all the metals which are soluble in mercury with the formation of amalgams, or which can be deposited electrolytically at carbon or noble metal electrodes. So all the metals, we can study them by using this technique, but the necessary condition is they should be soluble in mercury. They should be able to form an amalgam with the mercury, or another condition is they can be deposited electrolytically at the carbon or noble metal electrode. So when these two conditions are satisfied, any one of them is satisfied, that case you can study the metal by using the ASV. So generally, all the metals, many of them, they are able to do that. So we can use this technique of anodic stripping voltammetry extensively for the study of different type of samples to get the trace concentration of heavy metal ions. Now let us see the mechanism for anodic stripping voltammetry. So what is the mechanism here? This is my metal ion in the N plus oxidation state, and this is present in my sample. The source of the sample could be anything, but this is present in my sample, and this is a mercury present on the electrode surface. So this is actually pre-deposited on the electrode surface, and these are the electrons. So in the first step, that is your accumulation step, what happens? We apply potential equal to the accumulation potential, and for a time equal to the accumulation time. So here the reduction of the metal ion takes place by accepting the electrons, and after the reduction, metal becomes soluble in the layer of mercury. So it is forming a mercury amalgam. Now in the second step, when you are stripping the metal ion from this amalgam layer, now what happens? Again, you apply certain potential, and now your working electrode becomes anodic. So here the electrons are taken away by the metal, and it is converting itself into metal ion and released into the solution. So when you use the graph of potential versus current here, like in any other voltammetric technique, you can find out the type of metal and the concentration of the metal. So the mechanism involved the cathodic accumulation step, and second is anodic stripping step. So we have two steps in the anodic stripping voltammetry. These are the graphs representing your experimental work. So on this line you have taken the E, that is potential, and on this time you have time on this axis. So this is a potential versus time, and this is a current versus time. So you have two graphs here, where EACC is the accumulation potential, and your EP is the peak potential, the maximum potential that is obtained, the potential at which you get the maximum current, that is your EP. Then IP is the current peak, that is maximum current. A is the accumulation time. B is the rest period. Now you can see here on the time axis, it has been divided into different parts. So A part, this is your accumulation time. B is the rest period. C is the determination step. And D is the anodic dissolution of your mercury electrode. So when you discuss this, the upper part of the figure, it is the accumulation time in which the analyte is deposited onto the working electrode at a constant potential and with the sample solution being stirred continuously throughout the accumulation. So the upper part of the figure is this. So without the stirring, when you apply the E accumulation, the potential required for the accumulation, so when you apply it without stirring, what happens? It remains constant for certain time, and you apply it with stirring. Okay, initially you have to stir the solution, then only there will be effective accumulation of your analyte. And after some time, you need not to stir it anymore, because all the metal ions that could be possibly present in the sample, they have been accumulated already. So without stirring, now you can see there is constant decrease in the potential here. So as the deposition is always incomplete, the working condition must be strictly controlled if the reproducible measurements are to be achieved. So the working condition, you need to be very careful, and all these factors like the accumulation time, accumulation potential, the shape, size, and arrangement of the stirrer, then your stirring speed, that is the speed of the rotation of your stirrer, the sample volume, and surface area of the electrode, whether you are using the mercury drop or film electrode, you need to adjust the surface area of the electrode properly. So these are the factors which affect your accumulation part. When you adjust all of them properly, the effective accumulation takes place for even the trace quantities of the metal ion. So this is the upper part of the figure. So the accumulation, you apply it with the stirring, and after some time, when you stop stirring your solution, this potential actually falls with time. Then in the lower part of the figure, section B, in which you have a current versus time graph, the rest period is applied after this accumulation, and during this period, the sample solution is no longer stirred. You do not stir it. And why? Because here, you have stopped stirring, and you are allowing the different metal ions to enter inside the accumulation phase. So here the cathodic current drops because of the lack of convection. And as the small amount of analyte are deposited, even from an unstirred solution, this period must also be controlled. So here the rest period is also very important. Several seconds pass before the solution comes to a standstill, and the deposited metal is well distributed in the mercury drop. That is why the rest period is defined as being 5 seconds to a maximum of 30 seconds. So this much of rest period is required to apply here. Now next, this is the figure showing this difference in your current according to the time. So in this B part, you have stopped stirring the solution. So here you get a decrease in the current, a drop in the current. And when you further stop stirring, it drops like this, and there is increase in the current. So this is the second part, that is the stripping part. This one is the accumulation part, and this part is stripping part. So when you apply the stripping part, again there is increase in the current, and what happens, you get a peak here. So this is the peak current, and the potential respective to this current is known as your peak potential. So if. In the Mercury film, the distribution process is complete only after a few seconds. That is your rest period. Now, after that, section C is defined by the potential scan rate, that is delta E by delta T. To change the potential with a constant scan rate, which is the rate at which your anodic stripping voltagram is recorded. Now, the measured signal is C current IP, which in section D changes into an anodic current for the dissolution of mercury electrode. So here, by looking at your peak current value or the EP value, you can find out the which metal is involved, which metal is present, and by measuring the height of the peak, you can get the concentration. So here, the pre-concentration is done by cathodic deposition at a controlled time and potential. The deposition potential is usually 0.2 to 0.4 volt more negative. Why? Because you have to ensure the complete deposition of the metal ion. So it is 0.2 to 0.4 volt more negative than the potential of the metal having lowest potential, lowest E naught, that is standard potential. So suppose you have to you're analyzing the copper ions, then in that case you will find out what is the standard potential for the reduction of copper ions, and after getting that, you will apply 0.2 to 0.4 more negative potential than the standard potential of copper ion. So that you will ensure by this manner the complete accumulation of your iron inside the mercury layer. So again, you can see here, this is the accumulation step and this is my stripping step. And when you plot current versus potential, you can get peaks. So these specific peaks, they give you an idea about which metal ion is present in the sample. So these specific peaks can be used to identify the presence of particular trace metals. And you can get the accumulated metal amount in the amalgam. So you can use this equation, CmHg is equal to IACC, that is electrolysis current during the accumulation, TACC, that is your accumulation time, VHg is the volume of the hanging mercury drop, N is the number of electrons during the process, and F is the Faraday constant. So this equation you can use, and you can find out the concentration of your metal that is getting accumulated inside the mercury layer. So here you can see, this is the substrate. On the substrate, I have my bulking electrode containing a layer of mercury. In the pre-concentration or accumulation step, metal ions are coming onto the surface of the bulking electrode, getting reduced here, and the metal ions are deposited themselves into the mercury, forming amalgam. In the second stripping step, which is anodic in nature, the same metal which is deposited in the mercury, it is getting oxidized and converting itself into the metal ion, going again to the solution. Now, during this process, you get a peak, and the peak potential is actually, it is a characteristic of a metal. So by looking at that, you can find out the metal, you can identify which metal is there, and the peak intensity, it actually represents the metal concentration. So by getting these values, by plotting that graph, you can actually find out the qualitative and quantitative analysis of the trace metals present in any of the samples. So this anodic stripping voltammetry, this can be linear scan voltammetry, differential scan voltammetry, and square wave voltammetry. These three techniques are possible. And the difference is only how you are applying the potential. You are changing the potential with a constant rate, that is your scan rate. So that depends what pulse you are providing. So these three type of techniques are possible in the voltammetry. This is a linear scan anodic stripping voltammetry. You are changing the potential in a linear fashion. So this is linear scan anodic stripping voltammetry. Now, this is your differential pulse anodic stripping voltammetry. So if you can see, during the accumulation part, we are providing a constant current, but it is the stripping process in which we are providing the pulse of your potential. Differential pulse potential is applied here. So this is in the stripping part we are applying it. And now let us see the applications of stripping voltammetry. So analysis of available copper, zinc and manganese contents in the soil and vegetable sample. Then you can find out the contamination in the food sample, contamination of the toxic metal, pesticide, fertilizers, then drug residue, trace essential elements, then presence of dyes, organic compounds of biological significance. So these all type of samples, they can be studied by using the stripping voltammetric technique. And since this technique is widely applied to study the trace analysis of these contaminants, today we will also see experiment regarding that. The advantage of this technique is low cost instrumentation, allow to detect multiple layers, multiple types of dissolved metal in one experiment. So you need not to perform so many experiments if you are going to identify so many metals in the same sample. So in the same sample, one run with one experiment, you can get multiple peaks in your same record, and those multiple peaks, they give you an idea that all these metals are present. Then another advantage is accuracy and fast result. The technique is really fast and giving accurate results. And it is also sensitive and chemical species selective technique. So selectively, if you are looking for a particular chemical species, then also this technique is really very effective. So now to understand this technique very well, we will see an experimental procedure for the study of different samples using this stripping voltammetric technique. So now I'll show you how the actual experiment regarding this is performed.
So hello, today we're going to be covering how to use DPASV, which is differential pulse anodic stripping voltammetry, which is a really good method for trace analysis of toxic metals, which are usually found in the environment. So it's a pretty important method. We're going to be doing standard edition, which helps cover matrix effects. So if you're doing like river water or lake water, there's a lot of other constituents in there that could interfere with analysis. So this is a really good sensitive method. So, to start off, here's the instrument here. You have your reference electrodes and your mercury drop, pretty much the two main points. And it's also connected to nitrogen tank to assure that your sample can be purged properly. So it's really simple. You just pull this up here, and in the back it has a latch so it can stand. The first thing you want to do is clean your reference electrode, or clean the cell, which is what that's called. So to do that, you want to make sure your electrodes are always submerged in water. So you can simply take a 250 ml beaker that's been filled with distilled deionized water and just switch the cell for the beaker. So now that you have the cell, we can pretend that it's been washed with 50% nitric acid to remove any trace metals or any interference, because we're doing redox reactions, which is pretty sensitive to anything that may be in the cell or left over from when the person who used it before. So, to prepare your sample, you start off with some distilled deionized water. Just using an automated bulb. I'm going to take 10 mils. Make sure the bottom of the meniscus just sits at the top of the line. Just fill that up. Requires a little bit of patience. So there's always going to be that last drop at the end of the tip. You want to make sure you don't push it out, even though it's very tempting. Just because we're doing such small, small concentrations, you want to make sure your volumes are as accurate as possible. So now that the hardest part is done, We're going to add an acetate buffer, which is about half a mil. So this is a micropipette, which makes measuring small volumes much more accurate and much easier. So just take a fresh tip. So this is the only time, usually you wouldn't pipette out of the stock, but this is the only time you can, because the tips are very sterile and very clean. So you don't worry about contaminating the stock solution. So we're just gonna put half a mil in there. And get a fresh tip. Now we're gonna put 0.1 mils or 100 microliters of concentrated potassium chloride just to help with the redox reaction. Add that. Now you're almost done finishing your preparing your sample cell. And the last addition, of course, will be your unknown, which is highly diluted, which you get to prepare. So make sure you get a little beaker because it's pretty hard to pipette out of this guy because of the narrow flask at the top. And take about 1 mil of that, 0.1 mil of this as well. And now your sample cell is prepared. So now going back to the DPASB, you're going to switch your beaker for your electrochemical cell, which is this guy. So it's a really small volume, but the electrodes are deep enough that they will be submerged. And that's pretty much it in terms of sample preparation and preparing your electrochemical cell. Now everything at this point is all on the computer. So to start your run, you click start. And this window may pop up if you want to save and continue. You can save your data so you can go back to it if you want in the future. Right now, we're not going to. So this window will pop up just to tell you determination of the cadmium and the lead and the copper, which we're doing, so the experiment that you're running. And you don't have to change anything in this window. This just kind of helps you know which method you're running. So just click OK. So right now there's a mixer, which is ensuring that your sample solution is being mixed. And now it's being purged with nitrogen. The sampling does take quite a while, but it's very accurate. So it's worth the time waited. Okay, so that first click, is it the deposition time? That takes about a minute in itself as well. If you're not sure what's going on, all the steps are actually outlined in the computer, in the program, so it tells you exactly what it's doing and the time remaining. Now it's just equilibrating. That just takes a few seconds. And now when it says sweeping, it's actually measuring potential within the solution. And you should get, ideally, three nice peaks because we're measuring cadmium, copper, and lead. Perfect. So it's going to measure that two more times, so you'll have be more accurate. You'll have three measures of the same sample concentration. So that way it'll be much easier to calculate your standard deviation and your concentrations. So this is just the voltage versus the intensity, which is just your current. So it's measuring the current of solution, that's why you need your electrodes. And so basically when pretty much any changes in current will give you a spike, and each current is very specific for the metal because they all oxidize and get reduced at their own specific potential. So usually you'll get three peaks. And there will be different intensities because the instrument can be more sensitive for one metal over another. So just because this peak is bigger than this peak doesn't mean that there's more cadmium than lead. So once you have your three measurements, you're going to have a window that pops up here, and this is the manual addition part. So you can see it reminds you that you're going to add, you only need to add 0.1 mils to your solution. So with this micropipette, you just get a fresh tip, and we can pretend this is a standard solution. Just come over here. So you don't have to actually open it. There's a little plug here that you just remove. You're gonna take 0.1 mils and stick it in enough that it's just above the solution and dispense it. You put the plug back, and that's your first addition. So once that's completed, just click OK. And it starts the purging process and the deposition all over again, and you'll be repeating that procedure two more times. And that's pretty much how the basics of doing a DPASV analysis works.
After watching that video, now I would like to give you a question from this lecture. Yes, this is a question for you. You have to write down the experimental procedure for anodic stripping voltammetric determination of trace metals. So just like a lab experiment, you need to write it down in different steps, and after that, you will list out all the precautions required to take during the experiment. So this will be your assignment from today's lecture. These are the point of references for today's lecture. So that is all from my side for today. Thank you so much.